is generally when interest rates go up, you see certain stocks benefit, generally the ones in the Dow and the Russell and the S&P. And then when interest rates fall, the NASDAQ components like Apple and Google and Amazon, they take over with pushing to the upside.
You know, what's interesting today is that the S&P 500 didn't go down. In fact, it went up slightly. So
yeah,
equity investors are digesting the strong jobs report as good news. Now, I'm thinking this could just mean that the Federal Reserve is less likely to keep rates low, because why would they need to anymore? Shouldn't that be bad news for the markets? Shouldn't good news in this case be bad news? But that's clearly not the case.
Yeah, so this is a very interesting point, right? So if you look at the S&P's up a little bit. Why? Because people have more jobs, the reopening trades, the Las Vegas Sands, there's these other stocks that have really been beaten down. I mean, if you look at LVS, LVS just has gotten crushed because of the Delta variant, right? So the fact that we're seeing more people with jobs, the economy stronger, you're seeing a lot of the S&P components doing better. Now, if you look at the Qs, right? So take a look at the QQQ. What's the QQQ doing? The NASDAQ 100 is actually dropping 0.5% today because, again, the higher interest rates go, that's more negative for technology, high valuation stocks. So, again, there's this little disparity, this money flow price action that we're seeing, and we've seen this for the last couple months, is generally when interest rates go up, you see certain stocks benefit, generally the ones in the Dow and the Russell and the S&P. And then when interest rates fall, the NASDAQ components like Apple and Google and Amazon, they take over with pushing to the upside.
Okay, so we've talked about this before, topping action for the S&P 500. What's the trend right now? Are we still, this wedge formation right now? We're close to convergence, I see. Close, but not quite.
This is so amazing to me, David, because I just love charts and trend lines and something. And basically what you can see is that I've talked to you probably for the last two or three times about this converging wedge pattern on the S&P, and we've peaked below twice, once here and once here, and you've never gotten that secondary flush through. So to me, that's just games by the big boys, the institutions, the algorithms trying to tease us, essentially trying to get us to jump on the short side of the market before it really has proven itself that it has broken down. But the one thing you can say here about this wedge pattern is that those lines are converging, which means I would dare say in the next 1 to 2 weeks, you are going to either get a breakout or a breakdown of significance. And that I don't know for specifically which one it's going to be, but at some point in the next week or two, these lines are going to converge and it's going to force price out. So, I've said this in the last few days, but basically look for something major in the next 1 to 2 weeks. And maybe we can have another interview in about 2 weeks and just look and see if something happened. But something's going to happen here that's going to either cause a dramatic spike to the upside or to the downside.
Well, maybe another strong economic data release. Who knows? But let's go back to gold. People want to know what you think about gold now. We've talked about what has happened. What's going to happen next? Let's just take a look at the technicals right now. What's the next key level for you?
Yeah, so gold definitely breaking down over the last couple days. Now, the one thing to recognize is you haven't taken out this short-term low. You've just touched it. So that is technical support. I do think gold could go a little bit lower in the short term. There's another level just below here with this little pivot high, and that's going to be very significant support. Now, there is a pattern that I'm looking on the charts that's a bigger pattern that I'm following. And this is kind of my bull case into year end for gold as well as into 2022, which is an inverse head and shoulder pattern. So you can clearly see a shoulder here, head and shoulder. Now, to trigger, you have to get gold to take out this trend line. Once it takes that out, the GLD will go above 200 in pretty much, I wouldn't call it a straight line, but within a short amount of time over the course of a couple months, you could see a dramatic move up in gold taking out that level. So again, short-term choppiness, maybe a little bit of short-term downside. I'm still bullish on gold. Even if the technicals weren't involved, even if you didn't have this head and shoulder pattern, and remember, the head and shoulder pattern is within a longer-term bullish consolidation pattern here from this move up. But even if that wasn't there, you just have to have this long bias on gold over the longer term, because the printing of money is not going away. The government is going to continue to rack up debt. There's so many negatives over the longer term, including what I mentioned on the dollar, that is going to drive the dollar lower, which will also put pressure up to the upside on gold.
Short term, though, Gareth, are we done our descent for gold?
I honestly think there could be a little bit more. I don't think a lot, but this is kind of a trend line I'm watching on the GLD. On the GLD, this is at a price point of 163.70 to 65. So, I mean, we're at 165 right now. So that's another $1.50 down maybe at maximum. That would be my guess of the downside before it kind of stalls out. But again, that's your short-term support, and that would be my guess. And if that does hold, you still have a higher low, and then a higher low right here to look for on the chart.
If you take a look at the past on that chart, wherever we've gotten big moves, it doesn't happen a lot in a single day drop, but it has happened a few times. Each time has been followed by not as significant, but you know, somewhat of a rally. And then, and then depending on what happens, we can either get a consolidation or a further move down. So,
I think it's important to recognize, right, is that you see a lot of these bigger moves and then gold does come back. And what that's showing you is that there's a buy the dip mentality in gold. My guess is institutions and wealthier investors, as well as smaller investors, are seeing the same signals I do. And they may not be in the trading form, which is in and out very quickly, but they're saying, all right, listen, in the longer scheme of things, I want to buy the pullbacks on gold because I do see the 5-10 year outlook, which is very bearish for the US dollar and very bullish for gold.
Okay. Well, on that note, let's take a look at this chart that you've tweeted. So this is some research that you've shared with your audience on Twitter. What are we looking at here? You've got a bunch of years starting from the 70s to the 80s. You've got the PE of the S&P in the second column and then inflation on the right. So what's the relationship here, Gareth?
Yeah, so this comes from, you know, people were saying to me, you know, I've been saying that I'm generally bearish on the indices. You know, I think the valuations are a little ridiculous. And they all say, well, markets are going to go higher because, you know, inflation is going to create, you know, higher risk appetite. And you got to put more money into stocks. It's going to drive stocks up. Valuations can get even more stretched. And so I said to myself, you know, like, all right, this may be true. Let me do my research, right? And what I pulled up here, the mid-70s to mid-80s, you can actually see that the higher inflation, the lower the PE ratio. So for the S&P. So I think that's very, very important to kind of take a note on here, that it doesn't necessarily dictate that higher inflation will lead to a higher PE in the market.
Well, the PE, okay, I haven't, the PE could also go down because the prices of the equities have gone down, right? It could be because of a market correction. Could they not be?
Yeah, absolutely. So, I mean, that could be. But really, if you look at the market before 87 was our big crash, the markets were generally not doing that for this 10-year span. I mean, you know, again, if you look at the S&P over that period. So it doesn't look like that's the culprit here. And to me, if you think about it, right, so everyone's like, oh, well, more inflation is going to yield, you know, 20, 30, 40 times PE ratios in the S&P 500. But you have to understand that it doesn't quite work. It's not so linear. As inflation rises, what happens to companies, right? Their input costs rise substantially. So they are inevitably going to have more struggling, and therefore their stocks can actually, you can actually look at that their stocks are actually going to come down in that situation in a high inflationary environment.